everyone, and welcome to today's event, Understanding the Intersection of Privacy, Data, and Ethics. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I will be introducing today's panel, covering a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event. There is no call-in number for this session. Attendees are tuned in on a listen-only mode, so simply turn the volume up on your computer or smart device. And depending on your browser, you should be seeing all these boxes on your screen. And you may need to scroll down or to the right to see all of them. You can expand your slide area by clicking on the maximize icon on the top right of the slide area or by dragging the bottom right corner of the slide area. And while we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And there are resources you may find useful on today's topic in the resource list there underneath where you're looking at us right now. And since there are so many online today, and I know many more of us are working remotely, I wanted to call out just a couple of resources in case anyone starts having audio problems or other technical problems. Please see the question mark help widget at the bottom of the screen that will link you to common solutions to technical problems. F5 to refresh your browser is always a good first step. And lastly, I would recommend that if you are on a company network or VPN, if there's a way you can temporarily log off of that, I would recommend you do that as well, if that's possible. Now, today's session is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. For those in the audience that would like CPE credit today, we will broadcast three keywords in that Q&A area throughout the session. You'll see it at 15 minutes after the event starts, 30 minutes after the event starts, and then 45 minutes. And then just write the words down and enter them in the survey that's going to pop up at the end of the session. And going to that link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email that we send out 24 hours after the event. And additionally, if you attend the event for at least 50 minutes, the HRCI certificate will be made available using the certification widget at the bottom of the screen at the end of the live event today. And you can also find all this information in that certificate information box that's on your console to the far right. Also, I'd like to quickly review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice, and before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has nearly 60,000 employees and over 800,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance and workplace responsibilities. Now, I would like to introduce our distinguished panel today. I will start by introducing Don Weinstein. Don leads ADP's global product and technology team, overseeing client-facing product development and internal technology, CIO/CTO operations. And in this role, Don is responsible for ensuring that the global product and technology organization is aligned with ADP's strategic goal of becoming the world's leading provider of human capital management solutions. And then next, we have Jack Berkowitz. Jack joined ADP in August 2018 as the Senior Vice President of Product Development for Data Cloud, ADP's people analytics and compensation benchmarking solution. In addition, as the leader of the Data Cloud team, Jack is responsible for ADP's vision and approach to artificial intelligence and the development of cloud-native machine learning solutions that span across ADP's HCM product suite. With data across ADP's population of nearly 30 million employee records in the US, ADP has a unique position in the market to deliver unmatched insights to clients. And then next, we have Cecile George, who is our Chief Privacy Officer here at ADP. A former Paris Bar Registered Attorney with Master's in Information Technology Law, Cecile's expertise in both the European and international legal arena is reflected in her 18-year tenure at ADP. With European and international legal experience, Cecile leads ADP's data privacy and governance team, which provides advice and operational guidance to all of ADP's global business units. And then finally, we have today's host and moderator, John Sumser. John is the founder and principal analyst at HR Examiner, an HR technology industry research and analysis firm. He is also a senior fellow at the Conference Board and the Intelligent Tools Correspondent for HR Executive Magazine. John works with industry vendors and practitioners to implement and understand the use of AI in the HR department. Known for hard questions and easy to understand answers, Sumser is the HR technology industry's leading voice in the deployment of FX functions. So at this point, John, I thank you all for joining, and I'm going to turn the event over to you. I'm not hearing you, John. Let's are you see. Possibly on mute? Hey. There you are. Yes, I can hear you now.
Yeah, that little web, that little web bot told me something, huh? So thanks, Karen. Thanks, Karen. And thanks, ADP, for hosting this panel. I believe the panel is prompted by the release of ADP's Statement of Ethics and the formation of ADP's in-house Ethics Advisory Board. And since I spend a lot of my time talking about ethics inside of HR technology, I thought I'd just take a couple of minutes to talk about that some more. At its simplest, ethics is separate from morality and the law. The law tells you what you can and can't do. Morality tells you what's good and what's bad. And ethics is simply asking questions like, what's the right thing to do here? Or what could go wrong? Ethics doesn't ever arrive at hard conclusions about things, but instead tries to get the questions better and better. So we want to know, will this hurt anyone? How can we improve things? Ethics is a conversation at its heart. It's a practice rather than a set of rules. In the era of intelligent tools, when we're talking about how do you make your organization work well with artificial intelligence, we're setting a process in place with ethics that is different than corporate governance has been in the past, because we want to make sure that the tools that we deploy make our workplaces safe and healthy. And so in my mind, ethics is a part of a broad information age kind of safety program that you put in place because that's what's required when you have intelligent tools in your organization. At the same time, we're all in new circumstances. The pandemic prompted a radical shift in the way that work gets done, and it isn't going to change just because we get the pandemic under control. You see pretty interesting statistics about collapsing real estate empires as people start to move into the remote work situation rapidly. And so what happens now is that we're in a new way of working, and that means that every decision that you make is the first time you're making that decision in this environment. And that means having a good set of ethical frameworks so that you can ask questions about what works and what doesn't work is in your interest. And ADP is pioneering this. My view is that both HR departments and their vendors need an operational ethics function. It should be mandatory. You should expect it from your vendors. You should expect it in-house. An ethics function creates accountability. It ensures that every decision is better because there's an awareness of bias. It expands effectiveness by looking into the corners to make sure that we thoroughly anticipate the consequences of our decisions. It improves planning, and it improves the safety and health of the organization. And so that's why everybody should do it, and ADP is leading the charge. So I'm just going to walk through each of the panel members and ask, what does ethics mean to you? So Jack, you want to start?
Yeah, sure. And thanks, John. You know, I think you hit it pretty well. There were a lot of principles there that you brought up. It's really about that notion of discussion. And one of the key principles of discussion is transparency. And so it's whether it's transparency inside of the organization that's building the tools or using the data, or it's transparency for us when we're explaining to people, whether it's clients or the people inside of the companies, the end users or the people affected by the technologies, transparency about the information. And so that's one of the big principles to me is if we want to say that we're working ethically or that we're discussing things ethically, that we're transparent about those discussions and that we're transparent about the results and the findings and the way data is collected and the way machine learning or recommendations is provided to end users. And so that's a big aspect from my view.
Awesome. Cecile, what do you think? What's ethics?
So you mentioned the law, and since I'm the lawyer on the panel, I would compare ethics with law, and because, as you said, law and ethics are different, and they are not always aligned. So I would say that for me, ethics is really what forces legislation to evolve into the right direction. And what is the right direction is not unique, and we all have our own standards of ethics, and they vary from one country to another one. But I really like the approach of setting ethical standards that are going beyond the letter or even the spirit of the law.
That's great. How about you, Don? Take it home.
Yeah, no, I think obviously my colleagues really teed it up well there about, and John, your statement about going beyond just what's required and doing, you know, what we think is right. Obviously, you know, those tend to be sometimes complex discussions. And so one of the things that we've done, not just with the board, but also drafted our statement around AI ethics and release that publicly, because if we think what we're doing is right, then we ought to be transparent about it. And then, you know, I would just add, I think during the introduction, you know, it was shared ADP, we touch probably close to 50 million people around the world on an annual basis. So we take our position as a leader in the industry very seriously. And with so many people in the workplace, you know, being touched by ADP solutions, you know, we think it's very, very important for us to obviously do right by them, not just the clients who we serve, but ultimately their employees, or maybe it's their candidates or their recruits who are somehow being impacted by the AI tools that we're deploying. So we want to make sure that we're transparent about that, and also that we take that, adopt that position as being a leader in the industry and maybe setting the standard a little bit.
That's, I just want to take a moment and say thanks. I believe you led the charge to get this ethics stuff in place, and it really is industry leading. And really, I don't blow smoke like this. It's an astonishing thing that you've done, I think. So, Cecile, why would it, so you've got some ethics stuff out there. Why in the world would you start in a public way a process like this? Why would you start an AI ethics board?
Well, first, artificial intelligence, we all know, provides positive advancements, that's for sure. But at the same time, we have to be conscious that they also could lead to potential negative implications, and the usage of AI could lead to incorrect recommendation or reproduce or create bias into an organization. So it's true that it depends on the level of usage of AI into an organization, but one way or another, any organization, as you said earlier, will have to put some form of oversight on the way the company is using artificial intelligence. And this can take the form of a board, as we decided to do at ADP, but it could be a little bit less formal than a board. But the point is to have somebody or a group of people in charge of putting some governance around the usage of machine learning and artificial intelligence. And the reason is because companies are now held accountable by the regulators, such as the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, here in the US, or if you go to Europe or elsewhere on the planet, you will have data protection authorities or any other regulators that will really expect companies to implement compliance mechanisms with the principles that they have outlined. And those principles basically revolve around transparency, as Don mentioned earlier, ethical usage, fairness, non-discrimination, and also the explainability and the security of your algorithm. So in one sentence, I've mentioned security. I should have mentioned privacy, of course, but ethics. So you need a multidisciplinary group of people who will set principles and provide oversight and on your project and what you do and products that you develop or processes that you implement in your company, leveraging machine learning and artificial intelligence. And that's what we do with this board that we've set up more than a year ago. And the board is comprised of internal people, ADP people, but also external experts in data analytics, of course, machine learning, HR, ethics, compliance, and privacy. And the board reviews projects and advises the ADP business, first on the trends, emerging trends, but also on principles that that should be applicable and apply to our businesses.
Awesome. So, Jack, how does it work? What are the mechanics of this, and how do you pull it off?
Yeah, it's really what you started with, right? It's about conversations. And so the conversations, so the board meets periodically. As Cecile outlined, we have members from different disciplines that come together and discuss items. And so these items can be, you know, something trendy in the news, believe it or not, or it could be a new finding in the field, or it could be, for example, projects that are going on that are nominated or discussed and brought to the board for consideration. And so, you know, I, for example, am a member of the board, but I also have a product development responsibility. And so whether it's a project from my team, or maybe it's a project from another team that we may hear about, or even a project from our business units, we may decide, or we may ask them to come in, or in the inverse, we've just had a project where somebody's asked, hey, we have some questions, we want to bring it to the board. And then what we'll do is, you know, we'll probably do a little bit of pre-analysis by some people on the team in order to get some materials together. We'll do some reading, and then the board will sit down and have a discussion. Sometimes it's a bit of a presentation. Sometimes it's just a discussion, outlining sort of those ethical edges that we're trying to probe. Now, if something is something where we need to have guidance back to either a project team or to a position where ADP wants to take it, we'll do exactly that, right? We'll either write it up or we'll have that discussion. And then, you know, then the other half, if it's something for me, the other half of my personality has to come in and then go and implement, right? And then go and take care of those things. But again, it's really about that idea of getting a team of people together that may not work together every single day, but have an interest in creating the right situation, the proper situation for our clients and their employees, and discussing and understanding the implications from sort of a step back view. And that's the key. It's the key is those conversations.
It's interesting. I like the way that you're talking about it being tied to product development. I think that's why it's critical that you're there. It seems to me that you might experience feedback from the marketplace through product development that informs the ethics board. You think you're going to see that?
Oh, sure. And I think, you know, and sometimes it'll come directly from our clients. Sometimes it'll come directly, you know, in the observation of what's happening in the market itself. What we want to do is balance, right, sort of what we're hearing and then also what's right for our clients and for ADP. And so there may be an event that isn't anything to do with us at ADP, but something about whether it's an internet company or something about, you know, some technology that's been deployed, you know, autonomous something, right? Autonomous cars or something that actually creates a topic for us to understand and get our arms around. And so, you know, we're constantly sort of sensing the market. It's part of our diligence and making sure what we're doing is needed. And so we'll be bringing in those types of feedback. And again, you know, some of these come directly from clients, questions that clients may have, whether it's, you know, in the use of our software, or we get an awful lot of, have you guys thought about doing something, right? Or are you doing something in a space that maybe we, you know, it's ahead of us. And so sometimes we have our clients out and ahead of us as well, but we'll bring it in, we'll have a discussion, we'll go from there.
Thanks, that's great. So Don, you've got this committee. How in the world do you know if it's doing a good job?
Yeah, well, that's it's definitely a challenging question. I'll even turn it around for a second. You're like, how would I know if it's not doing a good job? And part of my responsibility we talked about is running all the IT infrastructure and operations. And like, that's the part of my job where I hope to never hear from anybody, right? And that's where, like, if they never hear from us, we think we're doing a good job. This is the opposite, right? If I wouldn't want to say, well, we never hear from anybody about AI ethics, so I guess we're doing a good job. I think that would actually be the wrong approach. You know, as Jack said, to the extent that we get questions from clients, you know, feedback, seeking to understand, if they're not engaging with us, then what happens is you have an ethics advisory board that gets together periodically, and if they're self-generating all their own topics, then they're probably undershooting the mark, versus if we're getting a lot of push and pull from the market, you know, if we're getting signals from the market that, A, these topics are important, they're interesting, they're relevant, and they want to dive in and understand more, you know, that's when I'll feel like we're really doing a good job on it, that we've got people engaged in the conversation, as Jack described, and ideally, obviously, that we're able to satisfy their requests. But I don't ever want to, you know, falsely take a false positive. Well, nobody's complaining, so it must be okay, right? That would be the wrong approach.
Thanks. What a great answer. So I'm going to just stick with you. I'm going to ask everybody, but I want to start with you. Diversity is part of this question. So what's the role of diversity initiatives in this ethics process that we're talking about here and in ADP in general?
Yeah, it's an incredibly important one. I mean, we take diversity very, very seriously, as I know you know. And it was part of the impetus here, quite candidly, one of the impetus for putting together this AI ethics board. You know, if I use the other term of art, machine learning, machines are very, very efficient learners. They're very fast learners, but they learn on what you train them. And if you have biases in your underlying, you know, data or patterns of decision making, then the machines can become very efficient at learning those biased patterns and repeating them. And so what you need to do, so if, you know, if we've had a pattern of bias in, let's say, our hiring decisions in the past, well, then the machine's going to learn who it is we like to hire and almost reinforce that. So we need to kind of interrupt that and put some high priority system interrupts in there and run some proactive testing to say, let's just make sure that we're not repeating the patterns of the past, that we're actually leveraging this towards a good, not a potentially negative outcome. That's really the ethics angle on this. I think diversity is one of those critical things where we're actually looking to hopefully use, when done well, I think AI and machine learning can help overcome the biases of the past. And we've seen examples like that where we can unpack hiring processes and take, you know, race or gender or other kind of ethnic indicators out and get a more, fairer outcome. And so that's when it's working well. But at the same time, we have to be cautious about and guard against that we don't just let the machine run amok and that it has the possibility of reinforcing a bias pattern. So we've got, diversity lenses that we put very carefully on all the work that we're doing.
Thanks, but that's a great product idea. Jack, what do you think about diversity in this committee and in ADP in general?
Well, one of the reasons why ADP is such a great place to work is that it believes strongly in the diversity principles. And, if you look across what we're trying to achieve as a company and as a nation right now, these things matter. Now, in terms of the committee itself, the committee thinks about and advises on these types of issues. Now, the committee doesn't go and measure bias, though, right? That's up to me as a product development person to do that. But what the committee will do is make those recommendations and then also understand what we've put in place to ensure that we're either A, measuring, being transparent about the systems, and B, making others aware of those capabilities. If you look at something that we've had out in the market for quite a while, we've just done a refresh out of my team in terms of pay equity. Looking at pay equity, looking at the edges of pay equity, and understanding the implications there. We know already by press reports what's going on in terms of potentially women dropping out of the marketplace, maybe even temporarily as they care for children at home, or it's an unbalanced caring of children at home. Males and females coming together and taking care of children at home right now during the pandemic, that's a great example. The committee will be talking about that type of issue, and then product development groups or our service groups will be working with clients to understand how that actually impacts, important principles like pay equity or benefits equity moving forward. And so it's really about A, shaping and understanding, where the edges are, but B, then making the right recommendations into the team so that we're producing the right products or accounting for the right situations.
Thanks. Hey, Cecile, so it's to you. What do you think the role of diversity initiatives should be in an organization's view of ethics? And what's the role at ADP? I think you're on mute.
Sorry about that. I was saying that as Jack and Don said, we are taking this extremely seriously at ADP, and we all are strong believers in diversity. Here, I'm going to bring my perspective as a privacy person, and also as I come from Europe. I would say that we still have to be mindful that diversity may take a different perspective and approach depending on where you are on the in the world. And in Europe, for instance, diversity may have a slightly different meaning compared to what we are used to here in the US. So despite all the good intent, when you collect data, you should not assume that it's always okay to collect information about sexual orientation or ethnic origins. And these are type of information that are considered sensitive data in Europe that you shouldn't collect without the consent of the individual and without having a legitimate purpose, if you will. So I'm not saying we shouldn't do that. Don't get me wrong here, not at all. But it's just that you have to take this into consideration and do a thorough analysis before you start collecting this information.
And to sort of, expand on Cecile's point, the contextual nature of bias is interesting because, I used to work in Europe as well. And whereas you may not collect things that we would commonly collect here in the US, they will collect other types of information that in the US we would not collect. And it depends even country by country. So, you know, the situational or the contextual balance as we figure this out is important. And it's important for everybody to, you know, interpret the information and balance the diversity information accordingly.
I was just noticing, Cecile, do you know of any other company in this industry that has a European as the head of privacy, an American company with a European as the head of privacy? That's awesome. That's really amazing. Don, can employees interact with the committee and customers, and how does that work if it happens?
Yeah. By the way, not too surprising to have Cecile, the European, be our global head of privacy. So we appreciate all she does for us.
But it's true. Sorry, Don. It's true that I didn't want to comment on John's comment, but I think it's pretty remarkable and telling about how ADP views all of these questions, because appointing a French person as the head of privacy. I took the role when we had to implement GDPR as well. So that was that was related.
That's great. That's really quite
those were fun times, Cecile. But that's a good example too, though. I think we looked at GDPR and it relates back to this. We viewed it not only as something that we had to do, but we took that similarly seriously as something that, you know, made sense and we wanted to do. And we wanted to do it right. And that's, you know, just two different ways that you can view something like that, which is, you know, the legal, what's the bare minimum, and then the, when respect to privacy, ethical, you know, what do we think we should do? I just see a lot of parallels between that and here. But then, you know, to your other question, John, yeah, in terms of interaction, 100%, you know, the comment I made earlier, if we're not hearing from people, we're not doing a good job. If the ethics board is kind of self-generating all their content and all their topics, they're bound to miss quite a lot. And so, for instance, on the ADP employee front, Jack actually recently gave a presentation to our entire 10,000 person global technology organization about the AI ethics board and how to interact. We had a wonderful recent example with a team of developers and product folks in our retirement services businesses. You know, we run a fairly large 401k business where they were working on some new models, ostensibly to encourage and help people make good decisions around saving for their retirement. Which, you know, on the surface of it, is a good idea. We can all hopefully agree with that, but it just takes you into some interesting areas where now we're dealing not just with our clients, but we're dealing with the employees. We're viewing them not just as workers as an organization, but as consumers, and potentially running into the area of, well, is now we're giving them financial advice? Should we be giving them financial advice? Like, where would we draw the line on that? It's a good question, because we have a lot of, I mean, we have millions of participants in our 401k plan. We have a lot of data about how those people do and don't save. And we can see, you know, relative to some models, that not everybody participates. Not everybody participates to the maximum amount. And, you know, generally speaking, we know folks maybe don't always choose the right mix of investments. Okay, so that's data. We have that. What do we do with that? How much can we do with that? And so the team, to their credit, this is the team in the retirement business, proactively came forward to the AI ethics board and was able to work with the team on the AI ethics side to figure out, okay, how do we draw the boundaries here that in a way that we can provide them data to help them make better decisions, but maybe not necessarily take us down the path of trying to give them, you know, too much advice in particular, because you don't understand their whole, like, we have some data, but we don't have their whole picture. So you run the risk of also committing malpractice if you overstep your bounds there, which is not something that that we would ever want to do. So I think that was a real successful, very, very recent outcome. Actually had that group come and share with my technology leadership team how that played out, again, to inspire this more interactive. And then on the customer side of your question, We've been proactively going out. We have a number of client advisory boards, as I know you know, and so we've been proactively sharing with the client advisory boards what the AI Ethics Board is, who's on it, how you interact with it. So we need to find some ways that we can scale. Obviously, when you have 700,000 plus clients and five people on your AI Ethics Board, you have the potential to get out of balance there. But we started with the client advisory board members, and our intent is to go even broader.
That's a great story. And so what you described, generally when people hear about an ethics board, they sort of imagine a tribunal that you present cases to and it whacks your hand off if you've been bad or something. You know, it's an enforcement agency. And what you just described is a resource that's useful enough so that the design process wants it in. That's a very different thing from an enforcement operation. And important. It's a nuance that most people don't get. So Cecile, would you just double down on this whole topic and talk a little bit more about how the committee reviews and influences product development? Is there a kind of an enforcement element to this?
Yeah, so I will add to what Jack and Don said and what you just summarized here, because you're right, that's extremely important, because of course you can imagine that in a company such as ADP, we already had a lot of controls and processes in place to review projects, and we have even within the software development cycle, we have, for instance, my team does privacy impact assessment. We have our global security organization and other functions that are involved. So how do we combine the role of the board with all of these processes that are already in place? And I think the term influence here is really key. And it started with awareness. So the board didn't reinvent the wheel. We first looked at what were our practices already within the company, because as you have all understood, we are taking ethics very seriously. And we started by drafting this statement that you mentioned, and that is published on our ADP.com website. So not only our associates, but also the marketplace can see these statements. And these are the principles that all of our associates abide by when they develop products and include artificial intelligence or machine learning. So we have completed with this board the processes that were already in place, but I think in a way that is really to influence, create awareness, provide guidance, look at the, so with our external expert, we have this outside-in perspective as well, which brings much more value than, like you said, a mandatory step that people would have to go through and just wait and expect that it's going to be okay, etc. So it's more to go back to the discussion concept that Jack mentioned earlier. It's really more about, discussing what is possible to do, what is the right thing to do. We don't want to limit the innovation and the creativity of people. We just want to help them do the right thing. And little by little, people are getting this awareness, and it's working pretty well.
And I think a key to it is that the collaborative nature of product development. We're in a creative process. Right. And by nature, a creative process is collaborative. And it's always looking for those outside influences and you know, whether it's competitive analysis or, you know, the input from the ethics board. And so what we find is that in the example Don said was, the teams were being creative and seeking that partnership. And I think that's an important thing that we have, you know, it's up to us to continue to encourage, but that's part of what we're trying to do overall with product development. You know, it's to allow people to express, but also to receive information. And, you know, that active reception of information is the key to making a great product.
That's a pretty interesting way to think about this. So the ethics board has has a function trying to make sure that the organization understands its influence. So it's a values generating operation that wants people to want to be a part of the process. And I think that's different than most hierarchical government forms, right? There's not a top-down quality to this, which makes it a fascinating experiment to me. So we're going to stick with you, Jack. Could you talk a little bit about how AI ages and drifts before we talk about how we watch that as an ethics committee? Because I think that's probably a new concept to the people in the audience.
Yeah, I think it is a new concept, right? And, you know, just the same way as even the general nature of data ethics is a new concept, the nature of machine learning is and AI is relatively new to most people. So, you know, Don kind of cited it. Machine learning is based on this idea that you can feed data, whether it's historical data or ongoing information, into a set of algorithms that do something, right? And so in the case of you know, a recommendation system, like if it's going to recommend me what product to buy, you know, it's looking at the information. It's looking at, you know, what other people are doing at that moment. It's looking at maybe news events in terms of products, and it's formulating a recommendation. You know, I happen to be a baseball fan. I happen to be a San Diego Padres fan. And, you know, a good recommender to me today would be go buy some San Diego Padres gear because they're in the playoffs. But the interesting thing about that is that it's not fixed in time. It's not like these systems are not a set of rules that are written once and then always exist. The world is constantly changing and the information is constantly coming in. And over time, the systems need to adapt or will adapt to that new data. And so there, you'll see examples in the press right now where, you know, the world was in a steady state or reasonably steady state until March 11th, when the president announced, you know, the travel shutdown. And then on March 11th, things changed in the world of work. And so if we didn't build systems, or if systems didn't react to that data change, the recommendations that they were making would be invalid, right? They would be based on, you know, just previous history from March 10th, right? That's not to say that history is not useful. It is, but the systems themselves need to change. And whether it's in a positive direction or a negative direction, the systems are all built to go perform a goal. And if it doesn't perform that goal, the phrase in the industry to indicate that something is changing is called drift. And so it's this idea that the goal behavior of the algorithm, whether it's to hire people, whether it's to do recommendations, whether it's to analyze information on your behalf, it may drift. And it could drift in a negative way. In other words, it's not giving you the results that you expected it to give, right? And that's the notion of drift. And the drift happens because you've built a system properly. It's reading the data as it comes in. It's trying to adjust, but it needs people in the loop to be able to correct.
That's awesome. So how does the panel get involved in watching and monitoring drift? Is that something that you can see at a system level, or is it down at the customer level that you can see it?
Yeah, so it's really interesting, right? So the panel, the ethics board, you know, says, hey, we as practitioners in this space need to have the responsibility to understand that drift occurs. It needs to have the responsibility to put tools in place to measure drift, right? So we don't just take our word that we tested the algorithm, it worked great on March 10th, and therefore we never look at it again. So the board makes the recommendation or makes the point to all the development teams that you have to be watching these things. And they could be, you know, all sorts of different things, accuracy of the recommendations in terms of hiring people, or it could be, things about bias. It could be all sorts of different characteristics. And then it's up to product development teams, service teams, to put in place the monitoring systems to catch drift. And it's actually pretty easy to see it once you put down that framework of actively managing your system. But we, as the board, have to enforce and remember, enforce is an overstatement. Encourage is probably the better statement. The idea of understanding the technology that you're working with, right? You can't possibly use the technology properly if you don't understand it. And so one of the things that we do is we make sure that people understand, hey, what are those algorithms that you've built? What is the data that you're using? If you're using third-party data, let's say we're getting even census data, right? And you're using that in your system, where does that come from? If you're licensing an algorithm, how is that algorithm built? So we could be licensing something in voice recognition or something, from one of the other, big technology vendors. How was that built? How are they measuring drift? Because that's our responsibility to our clients, and our, more importantly, responsibility to their employees and associates, to make sure that we understand all the pieces that come together so that when we produce an outcome, it's there. And that if things drift, we're aware of it and we can, quickly get our hands on it and correct the drift. Or maybe that is the new baseline, at least understand that and communicate it.
That's interesting. The ethics committee must have had its hands full with that historic change on March 11th. A lot of things changed, right, about them.
Yeah, it's been interesting.
Yeah, I imagine. Don, what happens when the committee finds something that it doesn't think is right? How does that go?
Yeah, well, and we've got a good case of that where that's actually happened. So I can share with you, what we did about that. I talked about there these common use cases within the world of AI in human capital management, be it, making decisions about recruiting, hiring, promoting, paying. So one of the models that we've been working with, and I know it's a popular one in the industry, is around predicting turnover. And so we've been building this turnover prediction model. And what we found, just in terms of the data, was that there were some indicators in there that had a risk of gender bias in them when predicting turnover. And the good news from that perspective is that our data set was rich enough that we found that we didn't actually need this particular indicator in order to produce a valid model. And so the first thing was just the recognition of it. And then the second thing was just took it out. Because to your point, I think if we don't actually make changes to the products, then we run the risk of not actually living up to that mission. And so I think that's a real live, use case of finding something, quote, not right, or, not something that we were comfortable with, not something that we felt, met the high ethical bar we set for ourselves. And so, actually proactively influencing product direction and influencing the factors in the algorithm happens in the real world.
That's amazing. So I'm gonna go back to each of you and ask, how does ADP ensure that its intelligent recommendations are right? There's all these forecasts and models, and you've got arms and legs of them. How do you make sure that the customer can trust the output of the system?
You want me to take that one first?
Yeah, why don't you go first, and then we'll get everybody else to disagree with you.
Always a risky position, but one of the things I'm very keen on is we use the term synthetic transactions. So, right. So what we want to do here now is again think about the types of AI. We use the term AI, and it's a generic term, and I find it can be much more useful and insightful when you get down to, well, what's the specific use case here? And you know, one of them, as we talked about, is just doing a best fit candidate relevancy. And there have been a number of experiments done in the world of behavioral psychology where they'll take the same candidate, but maybe they'll just change some, as I mentioned, either some gender markers or some racial markers and send the identical resume in and see what happens. And there have been a lot of behavioral studies on that have identified the hidden biases in the workplace. And so we can do the same thing now. And the beauty of it is we can do it at scale. Like, those experiments are good experiments, but they're, you know, they're done by people and they're slow and they're costly. But when you've got an algorithm that's running, you can constantly test and run synthetic resumes in, run them through the process and see what happens. We can see what happens when somebody what we try to do in all of these is err on the side of transparency, right? So we can say, here are the candidates we recommend. Here's why. Here are the candidates we don't recommend. Here's why. But you, the client, you know, you, the hiring manager, ultimately it's your decision. And so you can choose or not choose. And it becomes very, very interesting because, you know, I'd say 8 or 9 out of 10 times, the person making the decision tends to follow the recommendation of the algorithm. But every so often they don't. And we have the opportunity to follow that through and learn and see what happens, right? We do, we recommend that you not hire somebody or not consider them. We don't make hiring recommendations. It's candidate relevancy. It's, we recommend who you should interview. Sorry, Cecile would kill me for stepping over that. But here's the best matches your needs that you should consider. But you may choose somebody not among that pool. And when that happens, we can flow that through and watch what happens and test to say, well, maybe there's something that we're missing. And then likewise, running some synthetic transactions through, certainly to test for bias along the diversity and inclusiveness lens that we talked about before. I'm very passionate about that and doing it at scale.
Thank you. Cecile, what do you think? How does ADP ensure that its intelligent recommendations are correct?
So I totally agree with what Don just described, except, but he correctly put himself back on track at some point. So, but as I was listening to Don, I was thinking, so this transparency principle that we have with our clients and customers, the expectation is that our own clients would have this with the individuals and the people they are dealing with, because all of these tools that we are providing are here to make recommendation, as Don said, and assist our customers with their own decision making. And the concern from a privacy standpoint, the concern around the usage of machine learning and artificial intelligence is that people would be in a situation where the decision is made automatically by the machine and not by the people. So everybody has the right to the human intervention. And that's why what Don said is perfectly right, is that we are providing assistance and recommendation, but ultimately someone has to make the decision. And Jack mentioned that earlier, even in the programming of the algorithm and looking into the machine at some point and make sure that the machine is doing the right thing and not reproducing bias or taking the right data into consideration, you still need this human intervention at some point to balance the interest and the perspective here and make sure that, again, we are doing the right thing in the end.
So thanks. We have really zipped through our time together today. So let me ask you each to make some closing remarks about this, and then I'll wrap it up and take it home. So Jack, you want to go first?
Yeah. I mean, when I, you know, the topic is really about our AI ethics and data ethics, right? And as we talked, it's this notion of transparency. It's this notion of having an open dialogue. You know, whether it's for the creative processes of people developing the products, or whether it's with our clients and in turn with their associates or employees, to have the open dialogue about where automation, where information comes from, what it's being used for, and really what's the benefit of doing it. And once we can, you know, have that dialogue, I think, you know, the sky's the limit in terms of the potentials for things to come together.
Thanks. Cecile, how about you?
So one of our core values at ADP is integrity is everything, and that's really top of mind of each of us. So I would say that organizations should consider really going beyond what the law and what the minimum legal requirements are. And I think we spoke about that along this conversation, that doing what we have, what is required by law or what we have the right to do is good, but it's not enough. And you need to make sure that you're doing the right thing. And I would recommend to set up the right governance mechanism, as we spoke about, so a board or a committee to into your organization to ensure that those ethical principles are really taken into account.
Great, thank you. How about you, Don? You want to wrap it up?
Sure. And this is, I think this is a really important topic because the use of artificial intelligence and machine learning inside HCM products and use cases is growing exponentially. A lot of people, a lot of vendors are all pursuing this topic. You know, in my role, I get to see two different sides of it. I see what we're doing internally, but I also spend a lot of time with partners and other third parties, and I can see what they're doing as well. And, you know, I can tell you, not everybody is as sophisticated in terms of thinking through what some of the implications are that we've been discussing here today. And so, look, I would just advise anybody who is consuming these models, consuming these algorithms, or if you're in an advisory role, working with clients and customers, that the types of questions that you've asked here today, John, I think these are the right types of questions that everybody should be asking, you know, their vendors. How do you know it's right? What's the governance mechanism? What do you do if you find an issue? How do I interact with it? What's the kind of transparency? These are really good, important questions that everybody, we need to be asking our vendors before we just consume the outputs of whatever models they might be putting in front of us. And I think the need for it is only going to increase because the amount of activity and the number of models and vendors pushing it is growing quite rapidly.
Thanks, Don. And thanks, everybody on the panel. This has been a great conversation. I wanted to notice that it was a conversation and not me interrogating wooden heads with scripts like you might see on some other channels. I think that the fact that this was a conversation is walking the walk instead of talking the talk. And what's great about what ADP is doing here is they're setting a repeatable model that you can use in your organization to form an ethics advisory group that helps you navigate the acquisition of AI technology for your organization. So that is, I think, quite astonishing and may mean that you should bookmark this and show it to your boss. Thanks, everybody, for listening in, and thanks, everybody, on the panel again. Cecile, Jack, Don, it was a treat. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, John.
Yes, thank you all so much to our panel, to Don and Jack and Cecile and John. Thank you so much for guiding this excellent conversation and sharing your thoughts and insights around this topic. So with that, this does conclude our event for today. And as a reminder, your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email. And if you completed the instructions for CPE credit, meaning you entered the three keywords into the survey that should be popping up in just a second, you should be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation in the little CPE credit PDF in the resource list. Now, to receive ongoing communications from ADP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines, please subscribe to our Eye on Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen, or you can indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. And for more workforce trends and insights, we encourage you to visit our Spark blog link shown on the screen. And lastly, you can register for additional webinars, such as our next event on October 12th on strategies to survive year-end reporting using that link shown on the screen there. And on behalf of our wonderful panel today, myself, the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future events. Thank you again, and I hope everyone out there continues to stay safe.